Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Freelance Mindset, Unleashing Your Side Hustles for Better Work, Play, and Life by Joy Batra. Narrated by Jeed. Introduction. I never thought I'd be a freelancer. Growing up, I wanted to be a detective, an artist, and eventually a lawyer. Once I settled on that goal, I didn't question it. I loved the way lawyers talked and thought, the way they used words so carefully. I loved my parents' proud smiles at the idea. As immigrants, security and prestige often seemed just out of reach for them, but a law degree could offer both. Long before I had heard of the law of attraction or manifestation, I bought a postcard of Harvard Law School and stuck it on the wall of my college dorm room. When I was tired and didn't feel like studying, it gave me a burst of energy to keep pushing. By spring of senior year, I was within striking distance of my goal. I had worked my way up from C's in my freshman year and now had several straight semesters of perfect grades. My free time was a happy days of rehearsing with my Bollywood dance team, Musti, literally Hindi for fun. Our team had just won a big college-wide competition when my parents called from the hospital. My dad had a terminal disease called ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, and was in the intensive care unit every couple of months. This time, he had gone for a short operation, but woke up to the news that he would die within hours without life support. The semester ended in a blur. I finished my final exams, maintained my 4.0, and graduated. Only now, I wasn't sure I wanted to go to law school. Life suddenly felt short, and I wanted to explore what else was out there. I briefly floated the idea of doing something different, maybe business school, to my dad, but he was not open to revising my life plan in the limited time he had left. It was too risky. We decided I would take the law school admissions test while he was still alive. Then we would say our goodbyes, and he would stop life support. Everything went according to plan, except when we removed the life support. He lived. What was meant to be 2 hours stretched to 2 days, then 3, then 6. That day, my test results arrived. I unexpectedly scored in the 99th percentile and would have a real shot at getting into our dream school. "Dad," I showed him the letter, "I can go to Harvard." He smiled and patted my hand. 2 hours later, he was dead. Try as I might, I couldn't shake the feeling that he was waiting for those test results to come before he passed on. The following year, I started at Harvard Law School, but I longed to do more than law. I applied to business school and was accepted to Harvard's joint JD MBA degree program. I thought now my life would finally click, but I felt more lost than ever. I found myself scrolling social media in the library when I should have been studying instead. The captain of my college dance team had become a Bollywood actress, and her posts showed her dancing under palm trees. I wanted to feel as carefree as she looked, but I didn't dare tell anyone. Who would understand? When I snagged what seemed like my dream job so many years ago, a position at a fancy law firm, I tried to ignore the gnawing feeling that I wanted a different life, a life filled with adventure. After graduation, I discovered my dance captain's acting school had a course that fit exactly within my break between the bar exam and my new job. Perfect, I thought. I would go, have a quick adventure, and then settle into adult life. I flew to Mumbai and took the class. But I ended up meeting a producer who gave me an audition, and eventually a talent management contract. Just days before my new job was supposed to start, I had to make a decision. Should I take the traditional job with a secure path, or follow an unknown and dangerous road? My mom was understandably terrified. After all, despite my six-figure loans, we were on the brink of the financial stability she had sacrificed her whole life for. But to me, the acting contract was an escape hatch. It promised the excitement I craved. I declined the job offer and moved to India, bringing my debt with me. Spoiler alert, I did not become a Bollywood star. This isn't a fairy tale. I acted in some commercials, danced in a film, and got shortlisted for some bigger roles that didn't work out. Finding myself with a lot of time and very little cash between auditions, I pitched for part-time consulting projects. After a lot of trial and error, I eventually got hired. Surprisingly, this was the dream. I was finally in the sweet spot I had craved for so long but didn't know existed. I discovered I didn't need to work in a 9-to-5 office job to support myself. I could have time to chase my unlikely passions and also pay my bills. I now spent my mornings making Excel spreadsheets and PowerPoint presentations. I loved tackling these complicated corporate problems in smaller doses. Doing the work I had trained my whole life for was grounding. It gave my days structure. In the afternoons, I put on heavy makeup and a salwar kameez and rode a rickshaw to my auditions. Using a different part of my mind filled me with fresh energy. In the evenings, I dined with my extended family before exploring the city with new friends from my acting class. If I had taken any of the jobs I had considered during school, I would not have had so much free time to spend with the people who mattered to me. I would have missed out on getting to know my grandparents before they passed, or being with my friend at the exact moment she discovered she was pregnant. The story I had heard my whole life, that you go to school, then grow up, get a job, and give up all other parts of yourself, turned out to be fiction. I thought my only options were full-time job or no job. I didn't realize there was a third path between the two. I delighted in the hidden way of life that was now being revealed to me. This new reality was far more interesting than any fairy tale could be. Freelancing offered a solution that allowed me to have the best of both worlds. And even though I didn't know any of them at the time, millions of other workers around the world were forging similar pathways into a freelance life on their own terms. How and why I wrote this book. When I first started freelancing, I didn't know anyone else who was doing it. I had to discover this career path for myself, which meant I began freelancing later and with more confusion. And without a role model to guide me, I learned by making a lot of mistakes. At times, I felt ashamed, like there was something wrong with me because the idea of a traditional career didn't excite me the way it seemed to do for my classmates. I recognize that I've been very fortunate in both my educational opportunities and that there is a tremendous privilege to be able to turn down a hefty paycheck in order to look for self-actualization. Many gig workers, freelancers, and people with multiple jobs are not doing it by choice. They would love the opportunity to have a full-time job that offers even some of the benefits that others take for granted. The questions of whether to freelance, how to do it, and when are incredibly personal. Your answers will be driven by your unique circumstances and values. But if you want to explore what a freelance life could look like for you, this book is meant to help. While researching this book, I interviewed 50 freelancers, founders, and futurists about their experiences with freelancing. They told me why freelancing mattered to them, the biggest surprises of an independent career, as well as their hopes, dreams, and fears about freelancing. Many of them told me they delayed freelancing because they didn't see any examples of other people doing it. I don't want this to be the case for you. These interviewees held many job titles, including construction workers, baristas, store clerks, teachers, designers, filmmakers, writers, dancers, actors, musicians, engineers, lawyers, doctors, and even a clown. Some considered themselves freelancers. Others felt they were self-employed, solopreneurs, or entrepreneurs. One group saw their careers as portfolios with many components. Another group viewed themselves as having a side hustle or hobby on top of their day jobs. All these people are freelancers. The self-employed delivery person is as much a freelancer as the thought leader who gives keynote speeches and sits on a board of directors. This is because they are both at the center of their own businesses. They don't work for a company that will look out for their interests in order to retain them. Instead, they are paid to look out for one or more companies' interests, but must also take care of their own. There's a lot of tactical information available now about how to start freelancing, create your website, and get your first client. All that information is like a freelancing 101 course. There's less information about what actually happens once you become a freelancer. That's where this book fits. Think of it as Freelancing 201. It aims to answer the question of what comes next after we begin freelancing. How can we use freelancing to make a living and also build a life we find fulfilling? A life where you can grow in the directions you care about and make space for your many interests and priorities. I call this way of thinking the freelance mindset. How this book will benefit you. This book is for you if you feel lost or stuck in your career, unsatisfied with the day jobs available to you, or if you feel that there are parts of your personality you long to express but don't know how. If you think you are alone in feeling this way, like the outside world does not understand, this book will help you find your tribe. And if you want to take a risk but don't feel equipped to navigate it, this book will help you chart your path. You are not alone. You do have permission to make the changes you crave. You can take a step toward a more satisfying and meaningful life, even if it's something you've never seen anyone else do before. A Freelancer's Trail Guide. Luckily, on this journey, we have some guides. If you have ever watched Wonder Woman, Star Wars, or Moana, you've encountered what is called the hero's journey. This timeless story structure was popularized in the West by Joseph Campbell's 1949 book, The Hero with a Thousand Faces, and then iterated and adapted by countless scholars, including Maureen Murdoch and Victoria Lynn Schmidt, who developed versions of the heroine's journey. You, dear listener, are embarking on a heroic journey of your own. If you are questioning your limited view of a career as simply a 9-to-5 traditional job, if you are interested in using a freelance mindset to reconnect with your passions, or if you are looking for more freedom and flexibility in your working life, then you have already left the old world way of thinking. This book has four parts to match the stages of your journey, from stumbling into a new world to adapting to it, developing a new identity, and then learning to navigate both the new and the old worlds. The stages are presented chronologically, but remember, you are the main character of this journey and can navigate it in any way you like. Feel free to skip to the parts that speak to you and check out the rest another time. In part one, Crossing the Threshold, we find our illusions about the way we work are just that, stories we made up, or worse, stories that were made up for us. The current way of work is, in fact, not working for us. we discover there is another way, and much as we try to resist, we choose the road of adventure, which brings us to a new and disorienting world. Part 2, Navigating the Trail, has us do just that. Here, we get our bearings. We face trials and feel others' judgmental eyes bear down on us, but we also find support and start discovering what works for us. The third part, Becoming a Hero, examines a turning point. We now have the tools we need to exist as either freelancers or traditional employees, but we cannot go back to seeing the world in the limited 9-to-5 way we once did. Now we choose again whether to stay on this uncharted path of freelancing, return to traditional employment, or create something new entirely, taking from each world the elements that serve us best. In part 4, The Future, we compare traditional employment with the freelance lifestyle and observe the gaps between the two. We explore new models for incorporating the freelance mindset into our professional and personal lives in order to create a more sustainable future. Are you ready to unlock a whole new way of thinking about your work, play, and life? If so, let's begin. Part 1. Crossing the Threshold. 1. Why freelance? The circus was once a majestic big-top affair, where dozens of daring performers crowded onto a 3-ring stage. This was how David Dimitri imagined it as a child growing up in the foothills of the Swiss Alps. His father was a famous clown who performed with Marcel Marceau. When David was old enough to join his father on tour, he fell in love with the circus. David knew it was his life's calling. He trained at the State Academy for Circus Arts in Budapest and eventually earned a coveted spot at Juilliard. David started his postgraduate career as a freelance wire walker, performing in commercials for large brands before securing a steady job at the Metropolitan Opera. There, he walked a high wire in the opera Manon before moving on to do the same at the Big Apple Circus and eventually Cirque du Soleil. After more than a decade of performing in large shows, David grew disenchanted with the bureaucracy involved in a large circus operation. A rigid hierarchy separated the director, artists, and crew. The work also started to feel repetitive. "You do a couple flips on the high wire, and then what?" he said. "I wanted to do more." David made a decision. He would create his own circus. And so, L'Homme Cirque, the one-man circus, was born. L'Homme Cirque is the first show of its kind. It has only one performer, David, who does all the acts of a traditional circus: high wire, clown, mime, musician, ringmaster. He even shoots himself out of a cannon he spent 2 years building by hand. Between performances, David also functions as the circus director and technician. He markets his shows himself, sets up and takes down the stage, and even drives the truck for his tours. L'Homme Cirque was tremendously successful, touring almost continuously from its creation in 2007 until the coronavirus pandemic began in 2020. It's thrilling, both for David and the audience, but uniquely challenging. At a large circus, there are many performers, so if one gets sick, the show still goes on. But with his own show, the risk falls entirely on him. "You suddenly are your own boss," David said. "It's a big risk and responsibility that you have to take on, and nobody can take it for you." The work is difficult. It involves traveling alone, being far from home, and setting up and taking down the stage in the rain, snow, and mud. "It's rough," he said. "It can be very rough, the circus." And yet, David would not have it any other way. "The best part is the freedom that you have," he said. "Every night, it was my thing that I was doing. It never got boring. It was always a challenge." David has experienced his own call to adventure, just as hundreds of millions of people around the world have accepted a similar call. Fed up with the bureaucracy and limitations of full-time traditional employment, workers decide to go it alone. When they dip into the waters of freelance work, many people don't realize doing so also means creating and running a business, and many navigate these challenges without a strong support system or community. Freelancers share why they accepted the call. Starting his own circus has not been easy for David, but the rewards have been worth it. Even if you are not creating a circus, freelancing can be a challenging road to navigate. As freelance film director Alex Smith said, "Whatever reasons you have for doing it in the first place need to be pretty strong, because they will be tested plenty of times." We'll talk more about the specific ways these reasons can be tested later on, but let's start with why we are even drawn to freelancing in the first place. Financial freedom. Josue Tovar has been working since he was 14, first at McDonald's, then at a variety of other businesses. While these jobs offered much-needed income, Josue's prospects for financial growth seemed limited. He had immigrated to the United States from what he describes as a very poor family in a very poor village in Mexico. For him, freelancing was a path to financial opportunity. "I was getting tired of using my skills to make someone else money," he told me. "I thought that if I could just work for myself, it would be a lot better. I could grow and make my own company grow." Josue, now 26 years old, is a freelance roofer and the co-founder of a construction company with his three brothers. He is not alone in using freelancing to expand his earning potential. Research shows that freelancers frequently earn more per hour while also experiencing more flexibility and reporting higher well-being and mental health than their non-freelancing peers. For others, freelancing can be more of a stopgap measure. It might help you bolster your finances, tackle high expenses, or plan for the future. One freelance strategy consultant described using side projects to help ease the pressure from student loans. After finishing school, Sam had $100,000 of student loans. An interest rate of 8% a year created more than $600 of additional debt every month. By working a full-time job and also taking on freelance side projects during nights and weekends, Sam was able to reduce the loans and their accompanying stress to a level that felt more manageable. After achieving this goal, Sam eased back on the freelancing, but would consider starting it again if needed to save for another future expense. While we all have different financial goals and circumstances, for many people, about half of all freelancers, the additional money is our main reason for freelancing. But humans are complex, and money is not the only thing that excites us. Let's discuss two other possible reasons for freelancing. Creative fulfillment. You are naturally curious and passionate. As a child, before you needed to think deeply about money, you probably played games, had imaginary friends, and competed in sports. Those instincts might get buried as we grow up, but they don't disappear altogether. Freelancing can be a way to get back in touch with this pure form of ourselves, to stay in touch with our needs to play, grow, and learn. Ernie Valverde is a creative video editor at an agency and loves it. But as he progressed in his career, his work became more specialized. This meant that parts of the job that once felt novel now seemed almost repetitive. So he turned to freelancing on nights and weekends to go beyond video editing and work on related aspects, like video production and motion graphics for clients in different industries. For Ernie, freelancing is a way to practice skills that are related to his day job, but are no longer his primary responsibility. "You need an outlet," he said, "especially when you work in this type of creative field. It's too monotonous to do the same type of work every day, even if you're being creative within it." I was surprised to learn that his company actually encourages its employees to take on side projects, as long as their day job doesn't suffer. Supporting their employees' outside interests helps keep their workers happy and engaged, and it helps them develop new skills that make them better at their day jobs. As I spoke to more people, I discovered that many companies tend to be more open to their employees' outside work, especially in creative fields, where freelancing is more common. Author Rose Lake interviewed for and got a full-time job at a magazine while she was writing her first book. Some of her colleagues were also writing books in addition to their jobs, which made them more understanding when Rose used vacation days to go on her first book tour. Several journalists told me they were allowed to write pieces as freelancers for other websites, as long as that didn't interfere with their full-time writing jobs. In tech, many worked on side projects outside of their day jobs to get up to speed with new technologies and use cases. For this group, side projects helped them build skills and grow their networks in ways that made them better and more satisfied at their primary work. For others, freelancing is a way to scratch a creative itch that is completely unrelated to their day jobs. Chelsea Lorraine is a mechanical engineer and also a singer. A talented math and science student since high school, she weighs the balance between security and creativity. "I chose engineering because of its stability, but I've always wanted to do music," she said. Her combination of jobs may seem uncommon, but her manager, an engineer who is married to a singer, can understand Chelsea's love for the art form. "He gets it," she said. "I can have a terrible day. Then I go and teach 2 voice lessons and feel like a new person. That makes it worth it." Freelancing offers a breath of fresh air to these workers by allowing them to explore different aspects of their identities and to feel like they are constantly learning and growing. Autonomy. Working for yourself as a freelancer gives you a different level of autonomy than would be possible in a traditional job. Freelancing can give you ownership over your work, your time, or your career. Let's explore what each of these looks like. Alex, a freelance film director, decided to work full-time as a freelancer in order to focus his energy on the projects that mattered most to him. "My real goal is to do movies and TV," he told me. But after graduating from film school, the work available to him was directing videos for social media. He did that at first, but it wasn't what he wanted to do long-term. "There's your goal, and then there's all the suburbs around that goal," he told me. "It's really easy to find yourself halfway doing something similar but not the exact thing you crave. For fulfillment, that's a pretty dangerous place to be." After a decade of building up work experience, relationships, and some savings, he decided to go full-time freelance in order to focus on the projects that excited him most. "It can be fun or daunting," he said. "Personally, I find it fun, like a big adventure." Beyond the actual work, many freelancers love freelancing for the flexibility it gives you over your own time. Countless interviewees told me how much they appreciated the ability to decide when to take a long lunch with friends, travel, run errands, or spend time with family members without asking anyone else's permission. This resonated with me. The best part of freelancing for me was being able to make my own schedule and choose whether I wanted to spend my afternoon working from a coffee shop, auditioning, or just going to the beach. A final group of freelancers were drawn to this lifestyle because it gave them agency over their careers. John Cador, a writer who has been a full-time freelancer for several decades, said, "I started freelancing the way most people of my generation did. I got fired." His wife loves to joke that he is unemployable because of his strong independent streak. Freelancing harnesses that independent streak and turns it into a long-term advantage. John thrives by running his own business, setting his goals, and knowing that he is in charge of his destiny. Why do you want to freelance? Is it to have more money? More variety in your work? More ownership over your career? Maybe a combination of the three? You may want to jot down all the things you hope freelancing can add to your life and your career. They will be your guides as you explore the different kinds and configurations of freelancing to find the one that feels right for you. A new spin on a timeless tradition. When freelancing can offer so many benefits to our lives, why do so many of us delay pursuing it? Divya Chabra, a psychiatrist and writer, spent years not freelancing simply because she didn't know it was an option available to her. She loved helping families as a doctor, but longed to also do work that fulfilled her creatively, like writing. She didn't know anyone else working in medicine and the arts at the same time, so for years she thought she needed to pursue just one career or the other. "I didn't see examples of people who looked like me doing this combination of work, so I never thought that was for me," she said. "And then when I moved to New York, I realized these things are possible." "I similarly felt that my career needed to be binary, just law or just something else. When freelancing appeared as a third path, it was a brand new revelation. But it turns out that charting your own career, perhaps in a multidisciplinary way, has been around for a long time. Freelancers first appeared in literature hundreds of years ago. In Ivanhoe, a classic novel about the Middle Ages, a feudal lord describes his army of independent soldiers. "I offered Richard the service of my free lances, and he refused them. I will lead them to Hull, seize on shipping, and embark for Flanders. Thanks to the bustling times, a man of action will always find employment." This army of free lance soldiers was not beholden to any one employer. Instead, they offered their services to the highest bidder and refreshed their offerings according to the needs of the day in order to stay ahead of the pack. Although the novel came out in 1820, the phenomenon of freelance soldiers dates at least as far back as CE 1000. Today's freelancers offer a variety of skills and services. We are often referred to as slashies or multi-hyphenates, so called for the slashes or hyphens needed for our many titles and careers. While the words are new, today's multi-hyphenates are just the latest in a long tradition of people with wide interests and varied expertise, with a legacy that dates back thousands of years. The term polymath, from the Greek polymathis, having learned much, harkens back to ancient Greece, a hotbed of polymaths turned household names. Perhaps the most renowned was Aristotle, who weighed in on at least 15 subject areas, including physics, zoology, ethics, poetry, theater, aesthetics, economics, linguistics, and politics in the 4th century BCE. And circa 2650 BCE, a full 2300 years before Aristotle, one of the first polymaths of record was active in ancient Egypt. Imhotep was a chancellor, an architect, and a priest. After death, his legend continued to grow, and eventually he was considered the god of medicine. Farther east was Zheng Heng, the Chinese polymath who was a noted expert in nearly a dozen diverse fields. If he were a modern-day slashy, his name tag would probably include astronomer, mathematician, inventor, geographer, artist, poet, and politician. One of the earliest female polymaths was Hypatia. Active in the 4th century, she became one of the world's most prominent mathematicians, astronomers, and philosophers. If you've ever felt alone because you don't know others who had a career like the one you dream of, know that you are not. People have felt the way you do for thousands of years. Today, technology makes it easier than ever before to find work across industries and geographies, to meet people in different professions, and discover examples of the work we crave. Next up in this long tradition is you. How the freelance mindset can help. Neither freelancing nor traditional employment in its current form can offer a miracle cure to the challenges that capitalism imposes on our daily lives. However, incorporating a freelance mindset can shatter this false dichotomy and crack open a new way of looking at the world and our lives. Rather than simply two options, we have at least four types of employment available to choose from. Full-time job. Full-time job with part-time freelance. Part-time job with part-time freelance. Full-time freelance. We can adopt the new belief that no single job will meet all our financial, social, emotional, spiritual, and physical needs. When we acknowledge this reality, we gain agency. The problem isn't that we haven't made it, or haven't found our calling, or don't hustle enough. Rather, we are living in a system that was never designed with our personal well-being in mind. By acknowledging that, we now have the opportunity to rethink what is important to us. We can decide what we will and will not pursue, and consciously enforce those boundaries. With a freelance mindset, you integrate your need to pay the bills with your passions, side hustles, and relationships. In other words, instead of focusing only on climbing a corporate ladder, you strive to live a well-rounded life. This mindset is for you if you want to take joy in your outside interests, even though they might not earn as much as your other skills do. If you want to have a say in what, when, and how you work. If you want to invest in yourself and your ability to grow and develop new interests. And if you want to make yourself less dependent on one source of income so that if something goes wrong, there is a backup plan. Before proceeding, let's get clear about what a freelance mindset actually is. Table 1 outlines both some typical misconceptions about this mindset and some more accurate descriptions. Table 1.1. What a freelance mindset really is.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.